Hey, how's it going, everybody? Great to see all of you here today. I have I wanted to just begin by sharing some really neat news that I heard this week. Got an email from Jojo Martinez. Last week I mentioned to you that Jojo helps to lead a Filipino-speaking Bible study on Friday evenings, a life group, basically. And we received an email from him this week telling us a little bit about a project that they got involved in. You see, there's a prison, there's a small prison in a place called Tanza, Cavite in the Philippines. It houses 627 inmates in the most deplorable conditions. There are about 60 to 70 inmates crammed in each cell. It's really bad. And because the government doesn't have a lot of funds, the inmates are given only a small amount of food to eat every single day, and they don't have access to clean water. I think they take a shower about once a week. And when Jojo's life group heard about their plight, they decided to do something about it. So just amongst themselves, they raised about $600, and they decided, they just really thought long and hard about what they're going to do with the $600 they raised. Well, here's what they decided to do. They decided to contact one of their friends in the Philippines and then also a pastor and members of his church, and they decided to buy these inmates, 627 of them, a hamburger because they don't get anything to eat. Hardly anything to eat, and a bottle of water because they don't get clean water. And so they purchased all these things, and then they went to the prison and passed it out to them and gave it to them and also shared the good news of Jesus Christ with them. And again, these are just a couple of the photos that they shared with us that were taken on that day when they were there at the prison. And Jojo said that the inmates were so grateful, so thankful for the food and water that many of them just cried because they couldn't believe it. And then Jojo said there was some money left over. And so with the money that was left over, they went out and bought grocery bags of groceries for some of the families that were devastated by that recent super typhoon that just devastated the islands. And many of the homes like this one was just completely demolished. So Jojo was told that the people were so overwhelmed by the kindness of our church that they felt like they were blessed by an angel from above. And they put this little poster together and they just wanted to say thank you, South Bay Community Church. One man I understand who received a bag of groceries couldn't speak because he had suffered a stroke. But he couldn't say thank you, but the tears that were streaming down his eyes kind of said it all for him. And then after the project, Jojo received this note from their partners overseas, and it read this, and I'll put it up here for you. On behalf of 627 inmates of Tanza, Cavite, Philippines, and 75 families who received grocery bags, thank you so much, SBCC family and the Friday group of friends. You are the extension of God's hands to touch the lives of the people around us. No distance can separate us from the goodness and kindness of God. To God be the glory. And then Jojo signed off his email to us with this statement, this is us. This is us, a community of believers who care for one another, pray for one another, encourage one another, and help one another. And I just thought, isn't that great? Isn't that great? This is us. This is us. If you were here last week, you know that we're just doing this two-week series called This Is Us, last week and this week. This is us, and it's about the church. And the series is about who we are. And I wanted to just take a couple weeks to talk about the church because the church is so important. If ever there was a time when the church was needed in the world, it is today. And I'm not talking about a building because a building is not the church. The church is people. That's the biblical definition of a church. It is people. And in my opinion, the world that we're living in today is getting darker and darker by the minute. Evil and wickedness are just rampant. And everywhere I look, I just see people who are so lost and so far away from God. And that's why, as somebody once said, the church is the hope of the world. And the reason why the church is the hope of the world is because we bear the message of the good news of Jesus Christ. And if we are not there doing our job, then there is no hope for anyone. There's no hope for the world. And the problem is that the church itself isn't doing so well these days. And we talked about this last week. I mentioned that 85%, according to statistics, 85% of all the churches in America have either plateaued or they're on the decline. 85%, which means only 15% of the churches in this country are doing the job that God created them, intended them to do. And one of the reasons why I believe, we talked about this last week, one of the reasons why I believe the churches are dying today is because they're not following the biblical template that was given to us, the blueprint for the church, what it should be in Acts chapter 2. You know, last week I told you that Cheryl and I, when we went to Alaska some years back, we saw these totem poles. And on it are carved all these objects that symbolize and describe to all those who look at it, the various cultures, the North American tribes, what it is that they value, what it is they believe. It describes who they are. And in many ways, the description of the church is like a totem pole, and it's given for us in Acts chapter 2, verse 42 through 47. It's like a totem pole. It tells us, it really tells us who the church is and what it's supposed to be. It describes it for us. And so let me just kind of recap what we talked about last week, what it is we learned so far from Acts chapter 2, verse 42 through 47. First, we learned that the church is a word-centered community. It's a word-centered community. It loves the Word of God. It feasts on the Bible. It feasts on the Scriptures. And that's what we want our church to be. We want a church that loves the Word of God. Second, we learned that the church is a loving community. It is a loving community. It has a heart for people. And it wants to love each other. That's what we're supposed to do. Third, it is a serving community. It is a serving community. It is generous and sacrificial. When someone had a need and someone had no means to meet those needs, they would sell their own possessions to raise funds to meet those needs. It's a serving community. And then fourth, we saw in the scriptures that the church is a Jesus-exalting community. It is a Jesus-exalting community. And Jesus is the head of the church, and it's all about Him. The church is all about Him. And I believe this is us. I believe we're not all these things, or we try to be these things, but this is what we want to be. This is what the church ought to be. Well, today I want to show you the rest of the blueprint for the church. So if you brought your Bible, turn to Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2. Before I read it, I want to open up our time in a word of prayer. And I want to thank you for praying for Pastor Wayne this week. Pastor Wayne is such a dear friend of ours. Been here numerous times to speak to us. And I've been in contact with him, and he's doing well. He had his surgery for prostate cancer on Wednesday. Surgery went well. He was able to go home the very next day. And so he's eager to get back into the saddle and do all the things he loves to do. But he asked me to send his love to South Bay Community Church. So I want to do that today, just tell you that he loves each and every one of you. And I want to ask you just to keep praying for him. And so I want to open up our time in prayer and pray for the message, pray for our time today, and then we'll get into God's Word. Okay? Well, let's pray together. God, thank you so much. What a faithful and awesome God you are. Lord God, it's so good to come and worship you this morning. So good to be in your place today with your people. And Father, we're just so grateful, Father, for all that you're doing here, and grateful, Father, thankful for friends like Wayne Cordero. And God, we thank you so much just for you're having your hand upon him. I know that just thousands of people were praying for him. And God, thank you that he was able to go home just the very next day. And I can't even imagine. It must be a tough recovery, but we pray, Father, for your favor to be upon him. God, we pray that your favor would be so, so evident, God, that his recovery would be swift. But not only that, the pathology reports, when they get it all back, will indicate that all the cancer has been removed, that all of it's gone, that he won't even need to have treatments. God, we ask that in faith. We ask that, God, that you would do that great and mighty work in his life. And I ask, God, that you would do a great and mighty work in every one of us. Father, if ever there was a time the world needed the church, it is today. But God, as we learn, the church has faltered and has fallen, has taken so many hits. And Father, we pray today that you would open up our eyes and you would open up our hearts to what you want the church to be, not just South Bay, but every church in America, every church in the world, God. Because the church is the hope of the world. We bear the good news of Jesus Christ. And if we fail at our job, there's no plan B. And so, God, speak to us today. Use this vessel today to communicate your truth. I ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. And more than a dozen years ago, I made this startling discovery in the front yard of our home. I actually heard it before I saw it, but it was the meow of a tiny kitten. It was just a single kitten that was there. Apparently, the mother decided to abandon it in the bushes, bad mother. And I saw it there, heard it, and I looked at it. It was an early weekday morning, and I estimate that it was about a week to 10 days old. And the first thing that I did is I saw the kitten. I approached it, and as soon as I approached it, it hissed at me. And I thought, well, fine, if that's the way you want to be, then you're on your own, buddy. And so I you know, I'm not a cat lover by any means. I'm actually allergic to cats. And so I went inside and got ready to go to work, come to church. And being the nice guy that I am, I started to feel bad for this poor little putty cat. So before I left for work, I got a pie plate, a Marie Callender's pie plate, and I poured some milk into it, and I took it outside and said, here's your milk. And then I left. And I went to work, came back home later that evening, and I went to check on the kitty cat, and there it was still, and it was listless and weak, and I could tell that it was going downhill fast, and it didn't look like it drank any of the milk. So I went inside and told Cheryl about it. I said, hey, you know, I just want you to know there's a little kitty cat in our front yard there. And she said, really? I said, yeah. And I didn't want to tell Kylie and Natalie because I knew what, you know what, you don't tell your kids about those kinds of things, right? Because they want to keep it. So we went outside to check it out, and sure enough, it was there. And I said, hey, you got to be careful with this thing. This thing is dangerous. I mean, it hissed at me. So she reached out her hand, and of course, it went right to her. Ridiculous. And she picked it up, and she noticed it was skin and bones, and it was infested with fleas. It was disgusting. Well, by this time, Kylie and Natalie were wondering where we were at, so they came outside. Kylie was 10, Natalie was 6 at the time. And, of course, they saw Cheryl holding this little kitty cat. And it was over. It was over. First words came out of their mouth was, Daddy, can we keep it? Oh, it's so cute, Daddy. And like the good, wise father that I am, I said, no. I told him it was emaciated, it's probably going to die, so just let it die. And they begged me, oh, no, Daddy, you got to feed it. We got to feed it. Can we keep it? Can we keep it? And I said, well, hey, I tried to feed it. I gave it some milk, but it wouldn't eat, so it's just probably going to die. Well, Daddy, you got to get it cat food. You got to get cat food. I go, all right. You know, like, it was about 8 o'clock at night by this time. And so very reluctantly, I got in the car, and I made my way over to PetSmart, and on the way over there, I'm thinking, I can't believe I'm doing this. I can't believe I'm going to try to save this little kitty cat, because I don't even like cats. When I got there, I asked one of the helpers, I said, I got this, found this little kitty cat in my yard. What do I give it? What kind of food? Can you point me in the direction of the food? And she said, well, you got to give it milk. And I said, well, I did give it milk. She said, well, I hope you didn't give it cow's milk. I said, what kind of milk am I supposed to give it? It was Newton's 2% homogenized. What are you talking about? And so she said, well, it's, you know, cow milk is bad for cats. You got to give it a kitty formula. I said, are you kidding me? So she took me down the aisle to all the kitty formula. Did you know that they make formula for kittens? I had no idea. Couldn't believe it. And it's expensive. $5 for a can of kitty formula. $5, Mark. It was ridiculous. And so she says, you need one of those. I said, okay, I took one of those. And she says, you also need a bottle to feed it. I said, why can't I just put it in the pie plate? She said, well, kittens don't know how to lap at that point. So you got to feed it with a bottle. I go, oh, how much is the bottle? $8. $8 for a bottle, $5 for a can of kitty formula, $13. I thought, this cat's bad luck. 13. Well, to make a long story short, took it home, fed the kitty. Got the fleas out of it. You can't even use, I said, it's got fleas. Can I have some flea powder? I said, you can't put flea powder on a kitty. It's too young. You just got to comb it out. I go, oh, great. So there we are trying to comb out the fleas without getting bit. Well, we nursed it back to health. And this was not our kitty, but it looked just like this. It was an orange tabby. I found out that the orange ones are called orange tabbies. Looked like just like this. And much to my chagrin, it became part of our family. Of course, the first thing we had to do was name it, or they had to name it. And so they said, Daddy, is it a boy or a girl? I said, well, I don't know. I said, so I never had a cat before. So I just flipped it over. And I figured you can tell if it's a boy or a girl just like you can tell a dog whether it's a boy or a girl. So I flipped it over. And since it didn't have a boy appendage, I announced, it's a girl. It's a girl. So they named it Megan. A couple weeks later, when Cheryl took it to the vet to get its first shots, the doctor said, oh, it's a boy. So this is our boy, Megan. You know, well, there's a sad ending to this story, I'll tell you about that some other time. I shouldn't smile, but... In those first few months, Megan was totally dependent on us. I mean, just totally dependent on us. I mean, we were her lifeline. Because if we didn't pick her up and take her inside and feed her and care for her, she would have died. If we stopped feeding her along the way, she would have died. Or he would have died. I kept thinking he would have died. We were his lifeline. And in the same way as Christ followers, we also have a lifeline. That lifeline is called prayer. Prayer connects us with Almighty God. And the very simple definition of prayer is this: it is talking to God. That's prayer. It is talking to God. And communicating with God is an indispensable part of our relationship with God. If you don't talk to God, your relationship with God will wither and die instantly. It's important that we talk to God. Prayer is our lifeline to God. Martin Luther, who was the leader of the Reformation movement, said years ago, Protestant Reformation, said, to be a Christian, and I'll put the quote up here for you, to be a Christian without prayer is no more possible than to be alive without breathing. You can't be a Christian unless you talk to God. You can't be a Christian unless you pray. And in fact, the Acts chapter 2 church understood this. They knew this. They understood the value and the importance of prayer. The reason why 120 believers had gathered there in Jerusalem 50 days after the resurrection in the first place was to pray. They had a prayer meeting. Take a look at Acts chapter 1, verse 14 and 15. By the way, in your Baywatch is a sheet with your notes there. The verses are listed there for you, all except one. You can also open up our SBCC app. If you go to the Play Store or the Apple Store, you can download our app, and all the notes are there for you as well. But in Acts chapter 1, 14, verse 14 and 15, it says this: all these with one accord were devoting themselves to prayer. They came to have a prayer meeting together with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and his brothers. In those days, Peter stood among the brothers. The company of persons was in all about 120. All right, this is why I told you last week we knew that the church started with 120 people. 120 people gathered there, and they prayed. They were devoted to prayer because they knew that prayer was their lifeline to God. And while they were praying, the Holy Spirit came down from heaven, baptized them, filled them, and the church was born. Acts chapter 2. And then we come to verse 42, and we find the blueprint for the church. And right in there is prayer. It's part of the blueprint. Take a look at Acts 2, 42. It says, and they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. We talked about this last week. And the fellowship, we talked about this last week. To the breaking of bread, we talked about this last week. And the prayers, right? Circle the prayers. They devoted themselves to prayer. Why? I think it's because they understood the power and the efficacy of prayer. In 1 Samuel 7 in the Old Testament, if we can jump back to 1 Samuel 7 in the Old Testament, there's an inspiring story about how the Jews were gathered at a place called Mizpah. And their arch enemy, the Philistines, heard the Jews were there. And so they decided, they marched up to the Jews, surrounded them, this encampment, to attack them and to destroy them. They were the Philistines were their arch enemy. So take a look at 1 Samuel 7, verse 7. This describes a scene. It says, now when the Philistines heard that the people of Israel had gathered at Mizpah, the lords of the Philistines went up against Israel. And when the people of Israel heard it, they were afraid of the Philistines. And the people of Israel said to Samuel was their leader, do not cease to cry out to the Lord our God for us, that he may save us from the hand of the Philistines. And so the enemy is headed their way. He is about to attack. They surround the Jews, the Israelites, and the Israelites plead. They don't go directly to prayer with God themselves. They go to their leader, Samuel, and they say, Samuel, do not cease to cry out to the Lord our God for us. Pray for us, Samuel. We're being surrounded. They're going to kill us. Pray for us. Don't stop crying out to God for us. That's what they did. And so Samuel prayed. And you know what happened because he prayed? Take a look at verse 9. And Samuel cried out to the Lord for Israel, and the Lord answered him. And as Samuel was offering up the burnt offering, the Philistines drew near to attack Israel. And so the Lord thundered with a mighty sound that day against the Philistines and threw them into confusion, and they were defeated before Israel. God destroyed the Philistines. And we underline this in verse 10, the Lord answered, at the end of verse 9, the Lord answered him. The Lord answered him. I love that. I love these four words. God answered Samuel's prayers. You see, God answers prayer. Our God answers prayer. And there are a couple things just so noteworthy about this story. First, I see the desperation of prayer. I mean, these people were desperate. The Jews found themselves with their walls back, you know, with their backs up against the wall. They were desperate. They had no one to go to. They had no one to turn to except God himself. And that's why they asked Samuel to cry out to the Lord on their behalf. Let me ask you something. Have you ever had your backs up against the wall and you were desperate and you didn't know what to do? Maybe you're in that situation today. Maybe you're facing a situation and you have no idea how you're going to get out of this. You have no idea what you're going to do. Last night after the first service, a man came up to me and says, you know, I'm desperate. So right in the lobby, I said, let's just get on our knees right here. And we just got on our knees in the lobby and we prayed. We prayed that God would intervene in his life. Second, I noticed in the story, it's noteworthy to take notice of this, that the people had faith. The people had faith. The fact that they pleaded with Samuel to pray indicated that they had a modicum of faith. They didn't have much faith. I think they would have prayed themselves, but they had some faith. At least they had some faith. And the Bible says, Jesus said that the faith of a mustard seed can move mountains. So it's important just to have some faith that they would pray. And so Samuel prayed. He was their intercessor, and they witnessed the power of God as God destroyed the Philistines. And I believe in all likelihood the people, the church, Acts chapter 2, were familiar with this story. They certainly knew who Samuel was because they knew the Old Testament scriptures, and they recognized the power of prayer, which is why they themselves were devoted to prayer. And that's what the church does. That's what the church did in Acts chapter 2, and that's what the church ought to do today, and that's to pray. So write this one down. The church is a praying community. It is a praying community. The church prays. That's what God's people do. You know, it's mind-boggling to think of what God can do if the church prays. It's amazing. In 1857, James Buchanan was POTUS. He was president of the United States, James Buchanan. At the time, 1857, the economy was strong. It was robust. I mean, it was a powerful economic engine. And is often the case when things are going well, the country generally, with regard to their spiritual temperature, they were very cool. Because it's again, we see this even today. When things are great in your life, then you don't need God. When you're desperate, then you need God. And things were going great in the country in 1857, and people didn't need God. And people weren't hot for God. And this troubled a businessman named Jeremiah Lamphere. Here's a photo of him, Jeremiah Lamphere. He's a businessman in New York City. And it bothered him that things were going great, but the people, they weren't excited about God. So he decided to start a prayer meeting on the third floor of a room in an old church in New York City. He said, I'm going to start a prayer meeting because we need to pray. Man, we need to pray. And so he went around and tacked up posters around the city inviting people to come to his prayer meeting. Public prayer meeting on Wednesdays at the church, third floor, in a small room there from noon to 1. Just 1 hour, just come and pray. First prayer meeting was held on September the 23rd, 1857. September 23rd. When the clock struck 12, he was the only one there. 10 minutes went by, he was the only one there. Another 10 minutes went by, he was the only one there. 30 minutes later, it's 12:30. He waited for half an hour, finally heard someone coming up the steps. And then he heard another person coming up the steps, and then another and another. All in total, 6 people showed up for his first prayer meeting. The next week, 20 people showed up for his prayer meeting, and then on October the 10th, just a couple weeks later, October the 10th, the stock market went into a tailspin. The economy tumbled. Banks had to close. It was the worst financial crisis to hit our country up to that point in our history. It was called the Panic of 1857. And all of a sudden, his prayer meeting overnight just exploded. All of a sudden, everybody felt like they needed to pray. Lawyers, doctors, bankers, merchants, brokers, secretaries, clerks, they all started coming. Within 6 months, 10,000 people were coming to his prayer meeting. That's out of a population of 800,000 in New York City. 10,000 people were gathering every single day in New York City for prayer. He had so many people come that they couldn't hold it on just one day. So they added Monday, and they added Tuesday, and they added Wednesday, and they had Wednesday, Thursday, added Thursday, and they added Friday, and Saturday. They had to pray every single day because there were so many people coming. Sounds like what was going on in the Acts chapter 2 church. They devote themselves to prayer. The next year, Lamphere's prayer movement spread to other cities across the country in what's called the Second Great Awakening. This was the Second Great Awakening. And it is estimated that more than a million people came to know Christ during the Second Great Awakening, ignited by a prayer meeting in a small room in an old church in New York City. Wouldn't you love to see God work like that here? Wouldn't you love to see him do that here? 10,000 people coming to a prayer meeting, a million people coming to know Christ because of a small little prayer meeting. I wish I could say this is us. This is not us. We do okay when it comes to prayer, but I don't think okay is okay. We can all pray more. I know I can pray more. Evangelist D.L. Moody, who lived at the same time as Lamphere did, said this, put it up here for you. Next to the wonder of seeing my Savior will be, I think, the wonder that I made so little use of the power of prayer. Wow. Next to the wonder of seeing my Savior will be, I think, the wonder that I made so little use of the power of prayer. I read that and I was so convicted. I wanted to cry like, that's me. I make so little use of the power of prayer. Here God gives us this lifeline. And I know God can do anything. I know he can answer prayers. And I make so little use of the power of prayer. Pastor Mark Batterson said almost the same thing in more contemporary terms. He's a pastor today in Washington, D.C. He said, God won't answer 100% of the prayers we don't pray. Isn't that true? He won't answer 100%, guaranteed, he won't answer the prayers we don't pray. You don't pray, you don't ask, he won't answer. He won't give. So true. Let me ask you something. Do you make little use of the power of prayer, or are you devoted to prayer? Are you finding that God is not answering your prayers? Maybe it's because you're not asking, and maybe you're not praying. Hey, South Bay, if the church is supposed to be a praying community, then let's make use of the power of prayer. Let's pray. Let's start praying like we've never prayed before. Let's pray like we've never prayed before. I want to challenge you. I want to challenge you to start praying like you've never been before. Join us for our Tuesday evening prayer meetings. If you can't come every single week, I get that. We're all busy. Come once a month. Come once a month just to pray. You know, we average about 25 or 30 people, and that's good. But wouldn't it be great if we had 200 or 300 people every single week, right, to pray? Because we wanted access to the power of prayer. We wanted access to the power of God. And I want to ask you, you know, let's start praying like we've never prayed before. Pray for people around you. When you find out that someone has a need today, ask the person next to you, hey, how can I pray for you? And just pray for them. Don't tell somebody you're going to pray for them. Just pray for them right then and there. We call it on-the-spot prayer. And if you're not able to be with somebody when they need prayer, then text them a prayer or email them a prayer or call them and just leave a voicemail and leave the prayer on their voicemail so that they can hear it. I've texted a couple people recently who are having surgery and I couldn't be at the hospital, so I texted the prayer overnight, and then the next day after the surgery, the person said, I kept reading your prayer over and over and over as I was getting ready to have my surgery. We can bless people if we just became a praying community. Let's pray. Let's step it up. You know, last month, this last month has been one of the toughest seasons that I've been through in a long, long time. I shared some of that with you in the last couple weeks, but this was another hard week for me. This is just another tough week for me, and I don't know, I'm so thankful for my wife. I don't know what I would have done without her. She's been such a big help to me and a rock, but the other night, I fell into bed just physically and mentally and emotionally exhausted. I was exhausted and stressed out. This was like Tuesday night or Wednesday night, and I put my headphones on, and I opened up my Spotify, and I went and I started listening to some of the songs on my worship playlist. And I landed on a song called My Living Hope by Phil Wickham. Love that song, right? I just love that song. And I was so moved by it that I just kept playing it over and over and over again. And I'd sing it for you, but I don't want you to leave because my message is not over yet. So, but here are the lyrics, and I'll just read the two verses for you in the chorus. But it goes like this: how great the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished. The end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. And then the second verse goes like this: who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. And then the chorus: hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name. Jesus Christ, my living home. Well, I couldn't sing it out loud that evening because Cheryl was sleeping, but my soul sang it loud. I sang it so loudly. I was laying in bed and my hands were straight up like this. I'm serious. Headphones on and tears just cascading down my face. And I love that first line in the chorus: hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Praise the one who set me free. That's what we do when we're grateful, right? That's what we do when we're thankful. We praise him. We worship him. We bow down before him. When you're grateful for the salvation that he's given you, when you're grateful that Jesus died on a cross for you, when you're grateful that he drew you to himself, you praise him and you worship him. And you bowed down before him. When the Holy Spirit came down on that day of Pentecost and formed the church, you know what the people did? They praised him. They thanked him. They worshiped him because they knew who Jesus was and what he did. And now he sent them, the Holy Spirit, to live inside of them forever and ever and ever. And starting in verse 46, take a look at Acts chapter 2. Starting in verse 46, it says, and day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes. We talked about this. They received their food with glad and generous hearts. Verse 47, praising God. There it is. Praising God and having favor with all the people. And you can circle praising God. Circle praising God in the Greek. The word praising. This is really good. Get this. The word praising is a verb which appears here in the present active participle form. Now, those of you who are English majors will get this. Oh, that's what that is. It's a present active participle form. And those of you who aren't, here's what it means. A present active participle verb means that the action takes place repeatedly. The action is ongoing. The action is nonstop. The action is continuous. And since the word praising is a present active participle verb, it means that the church praises and it's nonstop. They're praising it. It's continuous. It's just ongoing. It doesn't stop. They were praising continuously. And that's why I love the Amplified Bible translation. I'll just put that one up here for you. It says they were praising God continually. That's exactly what was happening. They didn't stop praising. It's like, okay, we'll sing three songs and then we're done. No, they didn't stop. They continuously praised God. You see, the church is a worshiping community. The church was a worshiping community. You can write that one down. It continually praises God for who he is and for what he's done. And when you think about it, how can we stop praising God? How can you say, okay, I'm done. Let's do something else now. No, you just keep praising God because of who he is and what he's done. This is the blueprint for the church. We are a worshiping community. And that's why I want to say to you, I said this to you before, I'll say it again. Make every effort to get the church on time, so that you can praise God before the message. And then after the message, we tend to do more worship at the back end of the message, so that you will, after hearing the message, it's your opportunity to respond to God by, when you hear about who he is and what he's done, it's your opportunity to respond to him by praising him even more. And that's why we spend more time worshiping him at the back end of our service than at the front end. But when the message is done and I say amen, that's not your cue. Say, okay, I'm leaving, I'm going, because I don't like the worship. No, Now, if you have to leave, I understand that. Sometimes, you know, you got things going on, you got to leave. Go ahead, and that's okay, leave, right? But, man, if you can stay, if you can come early to worship God, if you can come early to praise Him, and if you can stay longer to praise Him after it's all done, then do that. And then when you leave here, don't stop praising Him. Keep praising Him. And whatever you're doing, keep praising Him, because that's what the church does. You know, when I lay down the other night, completely exhausted and stressed out, I put my headphones on. I started to worship God. For those 20 minutes that I did that, all I thought about was God. All I thought about was what He did for me. And I just couldn't help it. I got lost in worship as I praised Him. And for those 20 minutes, you know, all my cares just drifted away. I didn't think about what the last month had been like. I didn't think about what I went through that day. I didn't think about what I have to do tomorrow and the rest of this week, and I got to do all these things, and it stresses me out to think about it. I didn't think about any of that stuff. All I thought about was who Jesus was and what He did, and I just praised Him, and it was so sweet. Let me ask you something. What are you going through? What are you going through right now, today? Maybe you've had a bad month or a bad life, right? Praise Him. Just look to Him and praise Him and worship Him. You know, I just recently found a new radio station called, I think it's K-Love on FM, 100.3, brand new Christian radio station. I love it, which means now you can be driving in the car on the 405 and you could be praising God. They play a lot of the songs that we sing here at the church. And it's crystal clear. It's not like the other one station just goes in and out. You can't hear it. Like, this is great. 100.3. And now when somebody cuts you off, it's like, don't even bother you. It's like, oh, praise God. You're just praising the Lord, right? Praise Him. That's what the church does. You know, years ago, there was a movie called Titanic. Academy Award winning, won all kinds of Academy Awards, Titanic. And I remember when it first came out, Pastor Dave, he was a young guy coming to our church. That's how long ago the movie came out. I'll never forget it. He wasn't a pastor at our church yet. But he says, did you see Titanic? You got to go see it. He says, I've seen it 8 times this week. It's like, maybe he was in love with that girl. I don't know what it was. But there's a scene in the movie. It's so riveting. The ship is about to go down. And Molly Brown, who's one of the characters, is pleading with those who are on the lifeboat to go back and save some of the men who were thrown in the sea and drowning, and they're going to be dying of hypothermia because the water's so cold. Take a look at this scene, just riveting.
You don't understand. If we go back, they'll swamp the boat. They'll pull us right down, I'm telling you.
Knock it off. You're scaring me. Come on, girls. Grab an oar. Let's go.
Are you out of your mind? We're in the middle of the North Atlantic. Now, do you people want to live or do you want to die?
I don't understand a one of you. What's the matter with you? It's your men out there. There's plenty of room for more.
There was plenty of room for more. But they didn't want to go back. And they didn't. And that night, 1,517 people perished in the icy Atlantic. And all those people didn't have to die because some of those lifeboats were half empty. But they died because they didn't want to go back. They didn't care to save some of those people that were dying. Sadly, there are churches just like that today. It's all about them. They don't want to go back. It's all about their holy huddle, about their comfort. Maybe they don't like new people. I don't know what it is. But there's no emphasis, no concern about the lost, no concern about reaching out and doing evangelism. Well, that wasn't the church in Acts chapter 2. If you take a look at the end of verse 47, which you just looked at, it says, and the Lord, praising God and having favor with all the people, the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. The Lord added to their number day by day, every single day, those who were being saved. The Acts chapter 2 church, it just grew and it grew and it grew and it got larger. Their family expanded, and notice how it grew. At the end of verse 47, it says the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. Circle the word saved. This was growth by conversion. This was growth by conversion. This wasn't growth by moving people from one church to the other church. We call that transfer growth. Our church is growing because everybody from XYZ church is coming to ABC church. That's not genuine growth. The church grew when those who were in the church told those who were outside of the church about the good news of Jesus Christ, and they heard, they responded, they came to faith, and now they were part of the church. That's how the church grew. We call this evangelism. Another one of the reasons why 85% of all the churches in America are dying today is because those who are in the church don't want to go outside of the church and tell those who are outside of the church about Jesus Christ. Perhaps they don't want to because perhaps they're afraid to. Maybe they don't know how to, or they don't think they need to. Well, I want to tell you something, church. That's not us. This will never be us. We love telling people about Jesus. We must tell people about Jesus because so much is at stake. Think about that. So much is at stake. If we don't tell, someone could perish for eternity. What's at stake is nothing less than heaven or hell. That's what's at stake. And it thrills us when somebody decides to follow Jesus. And then our church grows and grows and grows. This weekend, I had the opportunity to meet a young man. He didn't know I'm going to talk about him, and I didn't know I was going to talk about him either, but I just had to say something about Akira Hikida, who's here today from Japan. This is Akira and Scott Hamada, his best pal Scott Hamada, but Akira is one of a little more than 500,000 Christ followers in Japan, but he just came to know Christ just recently, and Scott and Chaz and others, they went on a mission trip to Chiba, and they got to spend time with him, and Akira fell in love with our team, and so he's here for the week, he's here today, you can meet him, he's sitting right here in the front row, and then when he decided to come here, he told his friends from Arizona, because they went from their church there, from Arizona to Chiba, they had a mission trip there, they connected there. And they're here from Arizona today, here in the front row. And we love it. We love it that Akira is now part of the family of God. Right? And the angels in heaven rejoice. Right? You know, among the last words that Jesus spoke to his followers were these. In Matthew 28:19, he said, "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit." Go! Not stay, go. Where? To all the nations. And then in Acts 1:8, he said, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you." Hey, that's the baptism of the Holy Spirit, Acts chapter 2, the church forming, right? "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses." You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. Jesus said, go. Where? Everywhere. Go everywhere. Locally, that would have been Jerusalem for them. That's local, right? For us, it's the South Bay, right? That's local. And then a little further would be Judea and Samaria for them. That would be for us. It would be Southern California. It could be California. It could be even the rest of the United States. That's a little further. And then global, end of the earth. That would be our Japan. That would be our Uganda, our Guinea, our East Asia, our the Philippines. And this is the blueprint for the church. We're to go and tell others about Christ, not just locally, but globally. We're to go to the whole world. And so write this one down. The church is an outreaching community. It is an outreaching community. And this is us. We are all about fulfilling the Great Commission because there is no evangelism in heaven. And we will not keep silent about our faith. That's why on October the 20th, Saturday, October the 20th, we decided to participate in Saturate USA. And we're going to saturate Torrance 90504, just the area code that we're in, a zip code that we're in right here. We're going to go to 11,000 homes. We're going to go to 11,000 homes, and we're going to put a little bag together, and inside the bag will be the Jesus DVD. This Jesus DVD is the story of the life of Jesus, his ministry. It's been remade. It's well done. And it's about who Jesus is, and that's going to be in there. Those were all given to us from Campus Crusade organization, and we're going to put those in there, and then we're going to put in some information about our church. We're going to advertise our Harvest Fest so that people can, if they got children, can come to our Harvest Fest. We might have 500 kids here for our Harvest Fest. And then we're going to advertise a parenting workshop that we're going to have in November. So just want you to know about that. Heads up, we have Dr. Josh Straub to come back, and he's going to come back and do a parenting conference for us, just a one-day thing on Saturday. We'll tell you more about that. And that's all of this going to be free, right? There's no charge. We just want people to come. And we're going to go, and we're just going to go to 11,000 homes. That's how many homes there are in the 90504 zip code. And we're just going to hang these on the doors. We're not going to knock on the doors. So you don't have to knock on the doors and see if someone's home and talk to them. You don't have to do that. All you need to do is just put it on the door. And if we can get 200 of you to come and help us, we'll get it done in no time flat. If it's just 5 or 6 of us, we're going to be out there for about 2 weeks, right? 11,000 homes. But it's going to be fun. Bring the dogs. Don't bring the cats. Bring the dogs. Bring the kids. Bring the strollers. Bring the bikes. We're going to have a blast. And we're going to go through the neighborhood. And as we go through the neighborhood, we're going to pray and say, God, touch these people right here. God, whoever's in this home, touch them. Stir in their hearts that they'll come to know you. And we'll put it on there. God, compel them to watch this DVD. I don't know who watches DVDs anymore, but hopefully they will, right? And that's what we do. That's what the church does. And then I want you to know, and by the way, see the flyer in your Baywatch and fill it out and turn it in today. Finally, we're going to be sending a team to New Bern, North Carolina, to help in the recovery effort in the aftermath of Hurricane Florence. I mean, New Bern is this historic colonial town on the coast of North Carolina. It's devastated by Florence. I mean, it is estimated, this is New Bern just a couple weeks ago, it's estimated that more than 4,000 homes were destroyed and damaged in New Bern. And we heard from Samaritan's Purse this week, and they gave us a date for our trip. It's going to be Saturday, October 27th to Wednesday, October 31st. Write that one down. Alyssa's going to go, right? She already signed up. Saturday, October 27th to Wednesday, October 31st. If you are interested in going, let me know on your Connect card. Okay, don't tell me because I'll forget. Write it down on your Connect card, and we will send you an email this week with more information. We can take 15 people. We don't have 15 people yet. We could take 15 people, and if you want to go, I led the team to Rockport, and it was an amazing experience. And we're going to go there to North Carolina, and they're going to say, y'all from California? We didn't know there were Christians in California. And we're going to just go there, and we're going to help them clean up and do some things like that, and we're going to give them some hugs, and we're going to show them what South Bay Ohana is like, and we'll pray for them, and they're just, and many of them aren't even believers, and God will use us, because that's what the church does. It is an outreaching community. And by the way, you heard that there's a meeting today if you're interested in going to Uganda in January. There's an interest meeting later on this afternoon. I think it's at 1 o'clock. Come to that. According to the blueprint that's found in Acts chapter 2 then, let me wrap it up. According to the blueprint in Acts 2, the church is a word-centered community. It is a loving community. It is a serving community. It is a Jesus-exalting community. It is a praying community. It is a worshiping community. And it is an outreaching community. It's all right there. This is our totem. This is what the church is supposed to do. And do you know what happened when the church did all these things? Do you know what the reaction was? Take a look at verse 43. And it says, "And awe came upon every soul." People were in awe when they saw the church in action. Their mouths dropped. Their mouths dropped. And you know what they were in awe of? They weren't in awe of Peter who was doing the preaching. They weren't in awe of the people. They were in awe of God. They were in awe of Almighty God. When they heard the word preached, when they saw the church loving each other, when they saw the church serving each other, when they saw the church magnifying and worshiping Jesus, when they saw people praying for each other, when they saw the church reaching out, when they saw people coming to know Christ, they couldn't help but be in awe of God because he was there. They sensed his presence. He was with this church. And this church was firing on all cylinders. And beloved, this is what I want South Bay to be. I want us to be in Acts chapter 2 church. That's our template. That's our totem for this church. We don't have a magic formula. We just want to follow the template. And if we do the things that they did in Acts chapter 2, then we will be the church that God wants us to be. And I want people to come here and just go like, wow, God's here. Wow, how do you know that? Wow, look at the way you worship. Wow, look at the way people are praying for each other. Look at the way you love each other. Look at the way the word is being taught. Look at the way you, all these things. I want people to be in awe of God when they come to this church. And again, the only way we can do that is if we do all these things. We need to do all these. We can't just do some of these things. We'll just do worship and prayer. Oh, we won't do prayer because we don't like that. That's too hard. We'll just love and serve because I can do, that's easy. But we're not going to do all the other things. No, we got to do all these things. We got to bang away at all these things. And not only that, everyone who is part of the church, everyone has got to engage. We can't just have some of you doing it and some of you not doing it. We can't have the 80-20 rule. 20% of you are doing it and 80% of you are not. No, if you're a Christ follower, you are part of the church. By default, automatically, you are part of the church. Now, you may not be part of South Bay Community Church because you go to another church. That's okay. That's not what I'm talking about. But anyone who names the name of Christ is automatically a part of the Church of Jesus Christ, the overall Church of Jesus Christ. And it's not okay for you to be a part of the church and then sit on the sidelines and do nothing. It's not okay for you just to come to church, take in a week, an hour and a half service, and then leave. That's it. And that's the last time you have anything to do with church or God. That's not okay. If you're a Christ follower and you name the name of Christ, then you got to engage and you got to help us do every one of these things. That means serve. Serve. Everyone ought to serve. I mean, it just goes hand in hand with who we are as Christians, right? Man, we got this great God and he saved us. How can you not but serve him? Find a place to serve. You know what? Today's your lucky day. If you don't have a place to serve in our church, today's your lucky day because we have a ministry fair. And we have all these tables out there. You're wondering what's going on out there. All these tables are out there. And we got all these ministries. Man, we need more greeters. We need more ushers. We need more tech people. We need more what? We need more parking attendants. Mark is out there doing the park. We need more parking attendants. Man, some of the first people you see are the parking attendants when you drive in. And man, if these parking attendants are mean and grumpy, like, oh, I'm not, what kind of church is this, right? But man, we want people who are just excited, just like Mark. We need help everywhere. We need people to help clean the church. We need people to help with the hospitality ministry. So many areas. Please sign up. We need more help with the kids' ministry, youth ministry. What's going on? What did I say? Oh, join the team. Join the tech team. There's a shameless plug for you right there. Yeah, we serve. Second thing, if you're a Christ follower, love each other. We're a family, right? Welcome everybody who walks through those doors. Join a life group if you're not part of a life group already so that you can do life with others. You can't do life with 300 people. It's hard to do that. Right, but join a small group so you can do life with it. Open up your arms to everybody. Third, go. Help us saturate. Sign up to help us saturate. Consider going to North Carolina. Consider going on a short-term team, possibly to Uganda. Fourth, pray. Pray like you've never prayed before. Text prayers to people. Do on-the-spot prayer. You need prayer. Don't tell somebody you're going to pray for them. Pray for them. Just pray for them. It goes hand in hand with who we are. The church prays. Christ followers pray. And maybe God will use us to ignite a third great awakening. Fifth, make a commitment to read the Bible. Read the Bible. Read the scriptures. Come to church every single week so you can feast on the Word of God. Sixth, worship him nonstop, continually, nonstop. Just keep worshiping him because that's what the church does. Finally, seventh, always make it about Jesus. It's always about Jesus. Goes hand in hand with who we are. Your life is all about Jesus. We're saved because of Jesus. The church is all about Jesus. You know, one of the first things that the early church did in Acts chapter 2 was they celebrated the Lord's Supper. We talked about this last week. And the Lord's Supper was instituted by Christ. We read it in 1 Corinthians 11. It was instituted by Christ that we might remember his death, that we might always proclaim his death. You know, Jesus never said, celebrate my birthday. Christmas is coming, folks. Celebrate my birthday. You know, he said, no, proclaim my death. Remember that I died for you. And I can't think of a better way to end these 2 weeks just to celebrate and remember his death by taking communion. So that's what we're going to do now. We're going to take communion. And I just want to, so I'm not going to go over that whole thing again today, but those of you who know what communion is, if you're a Christ follower, this is just for you, all right? If you're not a Christ follower, then that's okay. You can just stay right where you're at. But if you're a Christ follower and you believe that Christ was God's son and he died on a cross for you and he was raised from the dead, then we want to invite you to come up in just a minute, a worship team will sing, and we'll have stations all around this room, and we've got, at each of these stations is a plate of crackers. Take a cracker, and you can eat it in remembrance of the fact that Christ's body was broken for you. And then there's a cup of grape juice. You can take that cup and drink it. And you take that in remembrance of the fact that Christ's blood was shed for you. And we encourage you, want to encourage you, if you, as you come up here, please don't take the elements back to your seat. Take it up here in the front. You can take as long as you want. As long as you want. We have gluten-free crackers in the back, I understand. If you need some help, just raise your hand, and a server, somebody will be glad to serve you at your seat if you're not able to walk up here very easily. And then there are little waste baskets that you can deposit your cups in. And then, again, as Roxy said, we'll have our offering basket up here in the front. We're not going to take our traditional offering when we pass the basket around. We want to have an uninterrupted time of worship right afterwards. So that will be here. You can also leave it with the usher in the back as you leave here today. But be sure to fill out your Connect card. If you've got a prayer request, if you want to sign up to help us with Saturate, any of those things, just fill all that out and bring that with you and leave it here. Or you can leave it at the Connect station as well. All right, so let's close our time and let's pray, and we'll celebrate communion together. Lord God, thank you for the church. Thank you for all that you've done for us, God. Thank you for sending your Son to die on a cross for our sins. Thank you that you raised him from the dead. And then 50 days later, you sent the Holy Spirit and the church was born. God, and I thank you for the scriptures and the blueprint that you've given to us. And God, I pray with all my heart that our church would be like the church in Acts 2. We would be all these things that Acts 2 church was. That in every way it would always be about you, that we would be loving, that we would be serving, that we would be praying, that we would be worshiping, that would be a word-centered community, that we would be a church that is willing to reach out and tell others about you, do all those things. And Father, most of all, help us to always make everything about Jesus. It's all about you, Jesus. You're the head of our church. You bought us with your own blood. And right now, we want to come and remember what you did for us, Jesus. Thank you for dying for us, for shedding your blood for us, for being crucified for us. And we come and we want to take communion together, and we remember all these things, Lord God. So, Father, bless our time, and then, oh God, help us right afterwards to worship you with all of our hearts because of who you are. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name, amen.